There's not a mother in this world who would watch her child cry in the street, stand and watch her weep. There's not a mother in this world who wouldn't give up her own life for the life of her child. There's not a mother in this world who wouldn't be happy to have a home for her family. We're all your home.
Yes, sister.
Hi, my name is Chloe. I'm from Canada. I'm a student here in Mumbai. And my question is why women are not accepted into mosque in India?
Sisters asked a very good question, that why are women not accepted in the mosque in India? So India has to blame, not the Quran and Hadith. I told in my lecture, do not judge Islam by looking at what the Muslims do or what the Muslim society does. Judge Islam according to the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, there's a Hadith in Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet said, do not prevent the female servants of Allah from going to the mosque. Another Hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number one in the Book of Salah, just a few Hadith before that, he said that if the female servants, that means the Muslim women, servants of Allah, if they want to go to the mosque at night, do not prevent them. Now, it is the Indian culture. Now, when we allow a woman to go in the mosque, we see to it that she gets equal but separate facilities, separate entrance, separate place of ablution, wudu, separate place of prayer. We don't believe in intermingling, like when you go to the church or when you go to the temple. Why? Because in our salah, sister, when we pray, we believe in equality of human beings. We stand shoulder to shoulder, irrespective whether the man next to me is black or white, yellow or brown, king or pauper, I stand close to him, shoulder to shoulder. Now, if a lady is there, close to me, shoulder to shoulder, the medical doctors tell me the temperature of the lady is 1 degree higher. If I pray standing with her, shoulder to shoulder, I will concentrate more on her than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, separate but equal facility. Separate entrance, separate place of wudu. You have to wash yourself, wash your legs. You can't do in front of the namahram. So in India, most of the mosques don't have, but alhamdulillah, it has started. I know of several mosques in Bombay where they have facilities for ladies. We have several mosques in South India where I've been to there, but I do agree with you, it is very less in percentage. If you go to Saudi Arabia, almost all the mosques, more than 95% of the mosques, they have facility for women, more than 95. Whether it's 99.9, I don't know. More than 95% of the mosques have separate facility for ladies. You go to London, you go to USA, most of the foreign, it is India. So the problem is with the Indian Muslims. Therefore, in my talk, I say that see to it, there should be a separate facility for the women. Separate, but equal facility, so that they too can pray to Almighty God in the mosque. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Thank you.
You're most welcome.
Yes, brother.
Good evening, sir. My name is Ashish, and my question is, there is concept in Islam by paying money to the victim's family. By paying money to victim's family from accused family and getting released from the crime, what is the concept behind that? And is it not injustice with the victim's family?
I'd rather ask the question that what is the concept of diya money, means paying blood money in Islam, that if someone has murdered someone or killed someone, whatever reason, the family members of the person who's murdered can excuse by taking diya money. This concept is that if someone is driving a car, or maybe by mistake while walking something happens, or by accident someone dies, here if it is out of negligence, yet for example a doctor is doing surgery and it is proven out of negligence the patient has died, Islamic law, death penalty. But there, the relatives of the person who has died, fine, we agree the niyyah was good. He didn't actually kill my son, I forgive him. But negligence, if it is done while trying to save a life, he goes scot-free. But if negligence does something and the person dies, then death penalty, because his fault. In this case, if it's proven it is 100% negligence, then the family members may say, even if it's negligence, I forgive him. Okay, I forgive him like free. I forgive him by taking 1 rupee or by the 1 million rupees. Maybe that 1 million rupee may be a penalty. Okay, don't do it again. Now you have done it. I don't want to take your life. I forgive you. 1 million rupees is a penalty. So this concept in Islam, that the person who has died, his family members can forgive by asking a penalty. If it is a conspiracy and a murder, 100% proven, then it is death penalty. These cases are mainly when we know that the person has a chance to be forgiven. If someone goes and does a bomb blast on the street and kills 100 people, innocent people, no forgiving, death penalty direct. You understand? Now, for example, while if you're doing something, maybe a building is being constructed, fine, and there's negligence, the worker gets electrocuted. It's the fault of the builder. Now the family members say, okay, I don't mind forgiving. You know, my husband used to give me every day 2,000 rupees. Now, if I demand 500,000 rupees, even his full life, how much could he give me? 25,000 a year? 5 lakh would take how many years? How many? 20 years. So now if I take that 5 lakh rupees, I can invest it somewhere and get 4,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees a month. Correct? So fine, I forgive him. And with this money, at least I can survive. The various aspects and angles, this is not the only aspect. I'm giving you examples. So in this way, what happens? At least in Indian law, finish, death penalty. But wo bichare ka bread earner to mar gaya na, usko fayda kya hua? Does the government take care of him? The earning member has died. The wife and children are on the street. Does the government help? No. So here, at least as a compensation, now they invest the money, every month they get 5,000 rupees. So at least some part of their life is taken care of. It may not compensate completely. And sometimes the person may just forgive without taking money also. So therefore, the various situations Islam has permitted so that it's beneficial for both. Hope that answers the question.
Anyone on the sister's mic?
Yes, brother. Hello, good evening, sir. I'm Sadia Akram. I'm a first year student of business management studies. My question is that you said that Muslim girls are prohibited the professions of acting, modeling, and dancing. Does the same apply for men, Muslim men?
This is the question that I said that profession which exhibit the body, like dancing, like modeling, film acting, is it prohibited for men also? In these cases of film acting, modeling, if it goes against the Quran and Sharia, it is prohibited. For example, a Muslim man, you know, models for some suit. As long as there's nothing haram in that ad, it's permitted. If something haram, if he models for black dog, whiskey, you know, or champagne or alcohol, it's haram. Similarly, if he's acting, if in acting he's showing that he's a non-Muslim doing idol worship, it is haram. You know, many of the Muslim actors, they behave like non-Muslim and they do shirk. Haram. Let him be anyone. Let him be the best actor in the world. His acting will take him to Jahannam. His acting will take him to Jahannam. But he's acting and doing a good role, not running after women, you know, running around trees. If all this nonsense is a hijab is broken, it's haram. Otherwise, simple thing, without any haram activity, not breaking the hijab, following the Quran and Sunnah, making films which are Islamic, which will get a person closer towards Jannah, closer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's perfectly fine. So as long as what they are doing, acting and modeling, if it comes within the purview of the Islamic Sharia, it's permitted, otherwise it's haram. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you, sir.
Who wouldn't give up her life for the life of her child? Ramadan al-Muhsini.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I am Zain Bika from South Africa, and I would like to wish all my brothers and sisters around the world Ramadan Mubarak.
Dialogue. Dialogue. Discussion. 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 Debate. 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 Rebuttal. 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 Conclusion. Conclusion.
Eliminate misconceptions about religion. Get enlightened.
Witness Dr. Zakir Naik in a battle of words in Crossfire every Saturday at 8:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 7:30 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Although Christianity doesn't have a single credible source to justify her claims of the crucifixion, she yet continues to propagate her myth. They do this by hiding many of their deceptions behind cleverly designed doctrines. Did you know that Christianity stands or falls at the cross? So how did they do this? So how did they do this? How did they do this? Join me for the series called The Cross Question.
Probe the past that proves Christianity in practice is fictitious in The Cross Questioned. Tomorrow at 6 p.m. and repeat telecast at 6 a.m. India on Peace TV. Stories of glories, often that thrill, fought the pangs of poverty by selling gowns at 13. His blindness did not stop his unquenchable thirst for knowledge. Propagated virtues, prevented vice with decisions unchallenged. He is Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Abdullah bin Baz, former Grand Mufti of Saudi.
Who wouldn't give up her own life for the life of her child?
Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. My question is, now the age of combined study, so is it permitted to study in field of medical, because for women? So because most of 99% is we face non-mahram.
Brother, I have a question, that is co-education permitted, especially in medical colleges, correct? If woman wants to become a doctor and there's no single-sex medical college, is it permitted? If the cause is there, the Islamic Sharia says, let a small loss take place to prevent a big loss. So now that lady, if she goes in a co-ed college of medicine and there's no single sex college, it will be difficult for her to maintain a hijab, but she can. She can, not that she can't. You know, she'll have to maintain a hijab. In medical colleges, the atmosphere is the worst. I've been to a medical college. MashaAllah, Allah saved me. Otherwise, medical college atmosphere is the worst in terms of breaking the hijab. Worst. And it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mashallah, who can save you. Otherwise, the medical colleges, you know, the girls and the boys, they have groups, they have to look, examine the patient, they stay overnight. It's very dangerous. If Allah is with you, inshallah, can be on the straight path. So for a woman, if she goes to a medical college, she has to yet maintain a hijab. And in the college that I was, there were Muslim women who maintained it. Not all of them, but there were one or two who maintained the hijab. Maintain the hijab. See to it that if you have to, suppose if the patient is common and you have to take a common history with another gent, you know, you have to take the common history of the patient. Maybe the colleague is a gent. Fine. When you talk, lower your gaze. Not, oh, how are you? How is the movie? Did you see the movie? No, all common. Oh, let's go for a spin. Let's go for a drive on the bike. So all these things, if you avoid, and see to it that if you have to talk with your colleague, you can talk with lowering your gaze, though the people will not like it. So she has to maintain a hijab, it's very much possible. As for examining the patient of opposite sex, the Quran and the Sahih Hadith give permission. Why? Because you're treating the patient. So doctor can see the opposite sex if required. Best is same sex, same doctor. Best. But you don't have it everywhere. That's the reason we, brother, we have initiated in our activities in the United Islamic Aid, a new activity called a free medical center. So we have started recently, which will inaugurate after this conference. Sheikh Salah Budair, the Imam of Masjid Nabwi, will be inaugurating our center in Mumrah on the 10th of November, inshallah, 2 days after the conference. The uniqueness of this center, it is on the lines of Quran and Sunnah. Means, lady doctor will examine lady patients. Gen doctor will examine gen patient. Is area 2,000 square feet. Separate waiting area for ladies, separate for gents. Children can go where they want, no problem if they are young. But lady doctor will check ladies, and inshallah, we aim to have only MBBS doctors and MD, you know, so that they're more professional. Everything air conditioned, but free. Good quality medicine. And inshallah, when I started this center, I'm a medical doctor. I intend to give better treatment in this free center than the own medical clinic that I have got. I've left my profession. My brother and my father, mashallah, they're doctors. And they're running a center, which is good. But there we charge. That's the bread and butter. We charge money. But inshallah, in this free medical center, inshallah, we'll give better services, inshallah, than the own medical clinic that we have for our bed and butter, inshallah. Fully air-conditioned, inshallah. Good waiting room. Hygienic, but free. Those who can't afford it, free. Anyone can come, even Muslims and non-Muslims can come. And in the waiting room, we won't have Stardust magazine, we won't have Filfair magazine, we'll have Islamic books. We'll have Islamic satellite channels. You know, people have, you know, you go to a high caliber doctor, Filmfare magazine, Stardust. So besides them getting cured by the diseases, inshallah, even the iman will get cured. Who are Shafi? It's Allah who cures. So what we believe, that if you want to do medicine, if there's no single sex college, you can, but you have to maintain your hijab, become a doctor so that more hijab can be maintained. Once that lady doctor becomes, Muslima becomes a doctor, she will allow many other women to follow the hijab. Hope that answers the question.
We'll allow only two more questions, one on that mic and the last question from this mic. And we have only 5 minutes left for Dr. Zakir to answer those. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. I am rewarded. My name is Abdullah Sheikh. Before it was a Sushen Kumar Mandal. I am from Panvel. But there is one question regarding Allahu Akbar, which I am always, I have read the Quran and I came to know that there is a Jannat, which I am trying to go Jannat directly. For that I have to follow the Hadith and Quran. But when I have read the Hadith and Quran, I came to know that I have to follow total Sunnat. This Sunnat has tried to put me down because of my mother. And my mother asked me to remove my beard, my cap, and all Sunnat. She want me to be like an Indian guy. She says me, you have to pray Allah in your heart, not by Salah. And this always Hindu, always try to put me like this. You do what? What we say? Shall I have to do like this, or I have to leave the house, or I have to stay other?
MashaAllah. Brother asked a very good question. Allah gave him hidayah. He became a Muslim. He realized that following Quran and Sunnah will give him Jannah. When he read the Hadith, he followed the Sunnah. He wore a cap. He covered his hair. He sported a beard. But his mother says, remove the beard. Remove the cap. What should I do? The verses I quoted of Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14, that we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. In travel upon travel did the mother bore them, but in pain did she give birth. Immediately next verse says, Surah Luqman chapter 31 verse number 15. But if your parents force you to worship somebody besides Allah, of which you have no knowledge, then do not obey them. Yet live with them with love and compassion. The same message is repeated in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 8. We have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. But if the parents force them to do something, worship someone besides Allah, of whom they have no knowledge, then don't obey them, but yet live with them with love and compassion. What we realize from Quran and Sahih Hadith, that you have to love your parents, you have to respect them, you have to obey them. But if they tell you something against Allah and His Messenger, that's the only time you can disobey them. But yet love them. So if they tell you to remove the beard, you tell, my dear mother, our beloved Prophet said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 7, in the book of death, hadith number 780, that do the opposite of what the pagans do, trim your mustaches and grow the beard. I am following my messenger. And that same messenger said, paradise lies beneath your feet. So if I remove the beard, even my paradise beneath your feet will go. Mother, I love you. Mother, I care for you. Mother, I respect you. That same prophet said that the person that deserves the best love and compassion is your mother. After that, do your mother. After that, do your mother. So if I stop obeying him, I will have to stop respecting you also. Mother, I love you. I respect you. I obey you. As long as you don't go against the person who's taking you to Jannah, that's the prophet. So depending how you speak, what you do, if you were not obedient to your mother before accepting Islam, maybe she told you, okay, wear a blue color shirt. Mother, I don't like blue color. Moment you became a Muslim, mother, I will wear a blue color. Hurry, what happened to my son? Before he became a Muslim, he used to disobey me. Now he's obeying me. So whatever your mother told you before you became a Muslim, which you never used to follow, the moment you become a Muslim, start following, as long as it doesn't go against Allah and His Rasul. You should find a change. Start loving her more. You have to respect her. Suppose she goes to the temple, doing shirk is haram. But the moment she comes out of the temple, it becomes your duty that you take her back home. Because you love her, because you respect her. Even though she is a non-Muslim, yet your paradise lies beneath the feet of your mother. Your mother may not be in paradise, but your paradise yet lies beneath the feet of your mother. Love her, respect her, obey her, until she does not go against Prophet and Rasul. See, there should be a change in your life, and she will respect you. She will also accept your religion. She'll even accept the sayings of Prophet Muhammad. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhra da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Sir, but there is one problem is that after she has converted into Islam, she accepted my Allah, but he is taking in the back of Allah, she is saying to me, you don't follow what the Huzur Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is giving you, the whole structures of the Islam, she is trying to stop. What shall I do? I should leave the house or I should stay away from her, because you told me that in the feet of mother, there is a Jannat.
The time is running short. You have to follow yet love her with compassion, because tell her that the Quran says Atiullah was your Rasul in Surah Nisa chapter number 4 verse number 59. So Quran says follow the messenger, therefore I'm following the messenger, not because somebody else is saying. So to follow the Quran, I have to follow the Hadith. You love her, respect her. If she kicks you out of the house, stay out of the house, yet love her.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Jazakallah khair, brother. We thank all our audience who has so patiently and consistently been coming here and stayed so long. Inshallah, we hope to see you tomorrow morning for our other programs in the forthcoming days. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.